My name is Emery Craig, Director of e-learning at the College of New Rochelle. My colleague Maya Georgieva is not able to be here today. She was here for our workshop back on Monday, but unfortunately she got tied up in a tech emergency, which had her riding the Northeast Corridor back to New York City to take care of some stuff. So this is really a joint presentation, but we have worked together for a long time, but I can't claim that it is all mine. It is also in good part hers. Anyways, let's talk about wearable technology. Its impact on learning, some of the challenges and opportunities, talk a little bit about the quantified self, data and privacy issues, because these are going to be major, major topics coming up over the next couple of years, and also thinking about a wearable tech strategy for your own institution. How many of you are using a wearable right now? We're getting there, starting to, right? Watches, fitness bands, stuff like that to begin with, right? Anyone have Google Glass or had Google Glass? Had Google Glass, right? Why do we say that in past tense? I know, sort of, we had it, now we don't use it as much. Anyway, so it goes. Okay, so let's dive on in, and hopefully at the end we'll have some time for questions. Very, very quickly, take a look at the long view, step back, the bigger picture here. Technology has been accelerating dramatically, especially since the 1960s. In our own decade, of course, tremendous, tremendous changes in the last decade. I think the smartphone was, you know, the iPhone was only came out, what, 2007? Not even that long. It's completely revolutionized mobile access to technology. If you go way back, though, of course, in the 1950s, computers were delivered on trucks. It took 12 or 13 people to get a computer off the truck and into a building. And not all that easy to run. My mom actually used to work on a mainframe, and when the personal computer revolution came out, she was like, I don't want one of these things in my house. I really don't. I can't take it. It's gone from that to devices such as this. MC10 is working on attachable computers that are basically the size of a piece of gum that include wireless temperature, heart rate sensors, and a battery, and you'll be able to just simply put it on your skin. It's estimated that in a couple of years, we may be wearing anywhere from 13 to 15 devices on our bodies, various forms of computing devices. Apple Watch, of course, Apple once again has stepped into a market and simply revolutionized it. It's estimated that they will sell about 15 million of the watches this year. They're not making their sales clear, but it appears that they sold about 4.5 million during the first quarter. So if that continues, then basically they are on track. Even more incredible, perhaps, is that in the short time that the watch has been out, there's now 7,000 apps available for it. More apps than you could probably get through in months and months of searching through them to see what you wanted to use. All of this, of course, is just baby steps, our first steps into the wearable revolution. We're just learning how to crawl in this world. We're not yet walking, and we're going to very soon be stumbling around and then hopefully getting up on our feet and walking on our own. So looking at the learning environment and wearables and where we are going, I think we need to think very creatively on this and draw upon a wide range of work that's currently underway in culture institutions, corporations, in the startup community, media, entertainment organizations. It's of interest that this is really the first year at campus technology that I've seen virtual reality vendors here, and I think we're going to see more and more of that as every year goes by. So much is going on in the meetups in New York in the startup community. Maya and I go to those meetings almost weekly, and it's amazing to see people from, I guess, age 12 or 13 on up to 70, getting up and demoing either hardware or software on a weekly basis. And in a very creative learning environment where people will try things and are willing to fail. And if they fail, they don't get disapproval from the audience. What they get is encouragement to come back and try next month, to try again once they get it right. So it's a very interesting kind of world that we're getting into here. And I think we're going to see more and more of this down the road. Virtual reality, of course, is a wonderful article in The Verge on this, I think about a month ago, or a little bit more, the rise, the fall, and the rise of virtual reality. We've been down this road before. It's been a fad. I can remember at South Street Seaport in New York City back in the early days, trying one of the first virtual reality headsets where basically every figure was outlined in sort of green phosphorescent lines, and you went into the space and you tried to shoot somebody else before they shot you. It was really, really primitive, but it was still kind of interesting. What's triggered the renewed interest, of course, is again, you could just say Moore's Law. Processor speed has just continued to increase phenomenally. Devices get smaller and smaller and smaller, and it becomes really possible now. It becomes an option to do it. Part of this, of course, is the low-cost virtual reality headsets that are being developed on the consumer market. Samsung, Sony, Oculus Rift, obviously, are all involved here. I'm sure you all know Facebook paid, what, $2 billion for Oculus Rift, and I think Mark Zuckerberg is thinking way ahead. He's going, people are not going to be sending text messages and posting photos on their Facebook pages down the road. They're going to be sharing immersive, interactive environments in 5 to 10 years. I think that's the whole reason for making the move into this. There's other firms here that are involved. I'm sorry, there's a spelling mistake there. It's Eon, not T-E-on. It's just Eon Reality is developing immersive virtual experiences. Eon is actually they work with oil and gas companies in the Middle East, and they do a lot of simulation training for employees there. And of course, you have these big rigs with hundreds of valves, and you can only turn things on in certain ways. And all the training is done through virtual reality. They now have the largest database of VR files. What they now started to do was to do some cultural sites like the temple at Luxor and the temple of Ramses II in Egypt. And basically, these are not things where you can really walk through, though you can use like Google Cardboard or Oculus Rift or something and be in a 3D immersive environment with the globe right above the one pillar there. If you put that in the center of the frame, you move to a different location. Many of you probably already heard of Microsoft's Project HoloLens, 3D hologram glasses. They're actually kind of fascinating. They're a combination of augmented reality, virtual reality. They bill it as the first fully untethered see-through holographic computer with no attached tether or anything like that. They call it a mixed reality. I think it has tremendous, tremendous possibilities in terms of the learning environment for three-dimensional learning demonstrations. I mean, my nursing faculty are looking at stuff like this and going, this is just absolutely amazing. Here we are buying all these mannequins, which, of course, we pay tens of thousands of dollars for, and, you know, 3 years later, they're completely out of date, and here we could do something with a much smaller device using software. I think when HoloLens comes out, it is going to be pretty pricey initially. It'll probably be somewhere between $2,500 and $3,000. But it will come down in price as technology already does. Very quickly, I can do a sort of movie of a live demonstration, I think, if I can get there.
Buddy, you can customize your space the way you want it.
This was a live demo.
I want to add something to my space. So I'm going to pull up my holographic start menu. And I'm going to open up Skype. I'm the worst at keeping in touch. So I'm going to take the people that matter most to me. And I'm going to pin them to this wall right here. That way, every time I walk into this room, I'll see their smiling faces and be inspired to reach out to them.
We're all creatures of habit, and we do different things in different spaces in our homes. This stage, as an example, is modeled after Darren's apartment.
Yeah, and this is where I'd hang out in my apartment and surround myself with the applications that I want to access or just check out. For example, I'm planning a trip to Hawaii in a couple weeks, so I placed this awesome weather app over here, so when I'm moving around, I can easily glance at it, reference it, and understand what the weather's going to be like when I get there, hopefully still hot. Then if I look up here on the wall, to my left, I've got a video player. I simply reach out, air tap, and I'm right in the action.
Now, What if Darren has things to do around the house? He shouldn't be confined to watching just on one wall. He should be able to take his entertainment with him anywhere and remain hands-free as he does it.
Yeah, so all I need to say is follow me. Now wherever I go in my house, my entertainment tags along.
Watch this.
All right. And where it gets where I'm going, I simply place it, and I can scale it as big as I want. Now, that's not something just a video player does. Every single Universal Windows app has the same capabilities. For example, I've placed a calendar over here because, as Alex will tell you, I'm late for pretty much every meeting. So this makes it, a guy like me, makes it a lot easier for me to just check in and see what I've got coming up next. We're discovering uses for holograms every day. We know with all you here at Build, putting your minds towards it, we're going to be discovering new uses every second. I hope you have an inspiring time at Build. We'll see you out there. Thank you, Darren.
Would completely change our notion of a media center, would it not, if you could just take your screen with you and walk down the hallway to the room you needed to use it in. Maybe we can get so many support calls at that point. I don't know. I have to see. I don't think everyone's going to be walking around wearing HoloLens all day long. It's one of those things you might wear for an hour or two when you're in the middle of doing a task, but it's very, very fascinating in terms of the possibilities. And of course, this is the initial iteration of this. Obviously, it will change as it goes along. So, and that was actually a live demo shot through HoloLens, so you could see how it actually looks. Going back to a somewhat simpler version of wearable tech and virtual reality, Google Cardboard. Google has already been distributing these for some time. There's now, I think, over a million Google Cardboards. How many if you have one? A couple of you have some? Yeah, I was going to be trying to bring one today, but Maya and I did a workshop on Monday, and we gave everybody Google Cardboard, and they all disappeared. So we had just enough for the number of participants. So unfortunately, even mine disappeared. So it went. But if you want to get hold of one, there's a number of sites online. You can purchase them from the running, anywhere from $10 to $20. I recommend I Am Cardboard, just because they're so simple to put together from that company. There's other companies where you open it up and you're following all the instructions for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and I Am Cardboard makes a very easy one that you can put together in about 15 seconds. Basically, with Google Cardboard, you slip your smartphone into it, you download some apps, first of all, some virtual reality apps, open them up, put it in, you have a split screen, you have instant virtual reality. So you already have the device, you already have the platform, all you really need is the cardboard to pull it off, which is pretty amazing when you think about it. So this is just getting started. What Google is planning on doing, what they announced at the recent I/O conference, is a project called Google Expeditions. That comes with a complete kit that an instructor would need for their classroom, for their students, to take them on a virtual reality field trip. They are going to make these available to schools globally. I'm not sure what the cost is going to be. They're obviously not trying to make money off this. It will at most be at cost. And it will come with a large number of cardboard apps. It will come with a tablet for the instructor so that basically the instructor can guide students through a virtual reality field trip anywhere in the world. It's pretty amazing when you think about that. So that even schools in areas where there's very few technology resources, there's just going to be a whole opening up here of I think opportunities through virtual reality. Quick little movie on this. Quick little video.
You could pick anywhere in the world that you want to go. Where would you want to go?
I would like to go to the moon.
Thailand.
Ancient Greece.
India.
To Nigeria, my homeland.
One or maybe all of the seven wonders of the world.
When you explore different places, you have the chance to actually learn something new.
You want to be able to show the kids that there's something outside of your community that you could go to and learn from, and that there's other places you can visit.
All right, so let's do our objective, and we'll talk about the lesson for today.
We're going to take a field trip to Verona, Italy, to see the place where Romeo and Juliet lived.
I'm going to take you on this field trip under the water.
OK.
Okay, you guys ready? Pick up your devices and look in your cardboard.
What is that?
I see a shark.
Whoa! Wow. To go somewhere we wouldn't normally be able to go.
Are we in China?
This is the Great Wall of China.
We got to see the place itself so we could actually understand what she was talking about.
How long would it take to walk the length of the Great Wall of China?
So much more enriching than just showing them a picture or just having them read about it.
This device can actually make us go to places that we've never been before.
It brings the lesson to you.
You have to see it for yourself to believe it.
There's so much other places to see, so you know that it's never gonna end.
I think it's a pretty amazing project, obviously, and it's, you know, have a huge impact on K through 12, but I could even see undergraduate students using it and, you know, developing a virtual reality field trip as part of a class project. So lots of interesting things here in the future. Finally, one other thing here, JewelBot, which just was announced recently, bracelets, basically programmable bracelets with little plastic flowers on it that are geared toward young adolescent girls, teenage girls, and the bracelets use Bluetooth, and essentially they glow and change color when you come when you stand next to your friends, when you get close to your friends, and you can take your smartphone app and you can do some basic programming on this to set them up. So they do two things. Of course, they leverage the social dynamics of young kids, but they're also teaching girls some basics in programming, which is pretty incredible. So moving on to challenges, there's design issues, there's power, battery life, and social acceptance. In some ways, all of these are interrelated, very, very close to each other. Wearable in 1971, yes, that is Steve McQueen. If you wanted to wear a camera, it took a lot of duct tape. And a strong head. The guy had a strong head, okay, let's face it. and I really think after all these years, the only constant in technology is duct tape, okay? It's the only thing that doesn't change. It's been there the whole way through. We still use it, and we were using it in the 70s. So, yeah, this is for the movie Le Mans, I think, 1971 or so, something like that. That's what you did. Obviously, we don't need that today. Steve Mann has been doing research for decades on this. It was formerly at MIT and now up in Canada. And if you look at the work that he's done, of course, it's the headsets have gotten smaller and smaller and smaller. I remember coming across Mann in Florence in the 1980s, and he looked like something from outer space with a great big antenna on top of his head, some like sort of crazy, Star Trek weirdo, and with a huge backpack with a huge battery in it. And, you know, he's walking around recording everything and talking to people, and he's, you know, he broke a lot of barriers in terms of doing this. It has gotten smaller and smaller and smaller over the years. As he moves on. Also take a look at the work of Gaudi Amit, who is the president and principal designer of New Deal Designs. He did the Fitbit, and he's working on some other wearables also. And he talks about this, and I think in ways that they're very interesting and we should take a look at. As he said in his own design office, he's got 30 to 35 people. The difference in the wrist size is 100%, from the smallest to the largest wrist. The largest person has a wrist twice the size of the smallest wrist in his own office, just people in his office. So it makes it very difficult to design. He said when we were doing Fitbit, we were trying to find that fine line between what a woman would wear that would feel not like overly heavy, overly masculine, and not something so thin and light that a man would not want to wear it. And he's like, we're just guessing in this area because we don't really know exactly where to go here. We're just trying things out. And of course, in all of this, the major challenge is battery life. You've all probably seen images like this. If you've been in an airport, we all end up looking for plugs because there is never enough power for our smartphones. if we have this kind of challenge with smartphones, we're not going to be able to do it with wearables. We're not going to sit on the floor next to a plug saying that we have to recharge ourselves. There has to be some kind of solution here. It's just, you're going to end up taking the wearable off, okay? I mean, even Google Glass got through maybe an hour and a half, depending on what kind of activities, and it was like, okay, it's starting to run out of battery. I have to find a power outlet to recharge this thing. That just doesn't work out, okay? There are solutions down the road. University of Washington, they announced a couple months ago, back in the spring, power over Wi-Fi. Some students did an experiment of just using signals from home Wi-Fi devices operating in the 2.4 gigahertz range, allowing them to power several remote devices, including a teeny camera. So that's the beginning of it, and maybe that becomes the way it is down the road. When we see that sign that says Wi-Fi hotspot, we'll think, oh, charging hotspot, not Wi-Fi, and we'll recharge as we're communicating with others. It's still a huge challenge, though. Elon Musk, of course, of Tesla, has said that he is so absolutely sick of seeing people send him proposals for batteries with increased life and solutions to power. He says, I don't want to see another PowerPoint presentation on this, just send me a working device or don't even come near me. Because it's just, he sees one possible solution after another. In the end, none of them work. He may be able to work this out in the end. Who knows? He's trying really hard. Not, of course, with wearables, but if you do it with cars, it might be able to scale down to something else. We'll see. In terms of design issues, this was Google Glass for a Halloween costume party. No, it wasn't. This was actually the early version of Google Glass. This was the prototype version. Isabel Olsen, one of the main industrial designers for glass, wearing an early prototype, which indeed was nothing more than a pair of glasses with circuit boards taped to the side. Obviously, you're not going to get much social acceptance out of something like this, right? Though I think actually this might have been more interesting than what came up. I think it's absolutely brilliant design, and if you crack it open and you can see slides online, images where people have done the tear down thing, it is an amazing exercise in design of how much they packed into this device. However, it reached a huge, huge obstacle, which of course was that of social acceptance. Hard to say if it was due to the actual design or it was just that they were first to market and somebody had to run up against this barrier. Maya and I used to walk out on Sundays and go get brunch over in the meat market district in New York City near Google's Eastern headquarters, and she would wear it, I wouldn't wear it. I'd be watching reactions to her, we'd kind of tag teaming on this, and it would be interesting because a lot of people would be staring and have this sort of initially hesitant negative reaction. And about a couple months in, and this is even in New York City where so many people were wearing it because you have all these Google employees there, the signs started to go up in the bars, you know, no Google Glass allowed, because people were getting scared that they were being recorded. Even though in actual fact, if you were being recorded, it was pretty easy to tell. There was a little light that was blinking, and the person that was recording you had to be staring directly at you. So it's, you know, there still just was a fear of this. What is interesting here in terms of design is that there's no fear of this whatsoever. Okay, Disney's Magic Band is a $1 billion project, probably costing even more than that, to wire, they are wiring their theme parks with sensors and have park goers wear a tracking device. There's no major issues with it. It's much more invasive of privacy than Google Glass could ever be, and yet people absolutely love it. Of course, Disney has sold this in a number of ways. How? Number one, it's a cute little design. Doesn't look techno like glass does, right? It's very, very easy. You can come up, take a look at it after if you want. I have one of them here. You can get it in all sorts of colors. You can order it in advance. You can get it customized. You get it. You go to the park. You use it for your admission. You use it for everything that you do in the park. Disney is now setting up restaurants where basically you can get to the door, look at the menu, decide what you want, go sit anywhere in the restaurant at any table, and your food magically appears. Well, your food doesn't magically appear. The room is filled with sensors, and you're sitting there wearing a tracking device so that the server knows exactly where you're sitting in the room. And that is the idea, is that Disney's going to roll this out. Of course, their goal here is to make the experience of being in the park easier, more enjoyable for people, which means what? Customers come back, they spend more money, it just works. So the theme parks are becoming, you might say, sensor realms, if you will. So moving on to quantified self, data and privacy, growth in devices and the Internet of Things. We'll probably have something like 30 million wearable devices by the end of this year. This probably more of this graph is completely out of date. And I think Cisco is estimating that there will be probably 500 million by 2019 or so, something like that. So it's just going to begin to take off, and we will all be connected to the Internet of Things. Can take a look at something like Spira. There's already a multi-million dollar market in the fitness and activity tracker segment, but now that's expanding to include devices that sense your emotions. You wear Spira, it's like a small stone. You wear it on the inside of your belt next to your skin or inside of your shirt. And basically, it tracks your breathing. It tries to assess whether you're agitated or not, and then sends you little signals to take a deep breath, to calm down. Right? Just calm down. Stop. Right? Not an option in New York City, but whatever. There's also Think, which is really interesting. It is actually a startup here in Boston. $299 device, easily portable, lightweight, wear it on the side of your head. And so instead of having a cup of coffee when you really need to get some work done, or having a glass of wine when you really need to relax, and having to live with the consequences of that for the next 4 or 5 hours of I'm hyperactive or I'm relaxed, with Think, the idea is that in 30 minutes I can dial my energy level up or I can dial my energy level down. You could see students doing something like this, could you not, down the road? I don't know. They may all be sitting there in our classrooms wearing a little something on the side of their head. The other thing here, and you can also take a look at this later on, the Muse brain sensing headband, fascinating device. It just tries to get you to calm down. It reads your brain waves. You listen to sounds of the ocean, and the more agitated you are, the louder the waves get, to the tsunami-like. Yeah, I've learned to only do it on weekends, not to try it on a weekday. It's coming home from work and living in Greenwich Village. But, when you calm down, the waves become a slight little trickle, just so the soothing sound of water, and you hear birds in the background. And there's even a little gamification going on with it, that you can earn points and unlock more features. I haven't been able to unlock the additional features because I'm always too agitated, but that's the way it is. I'll get there someday. But I do like that idea. I wish we could hand out laptops to faculty and staff and say, once you master this, it unlocks additional features. You get a color screen when you do this, something like that, instead of saying, help me do something. I don't know. What's interesting with this, first of all, the device has been hacked. So people up in Canada where this was started have already been using it to control computer screens, control computer devices. But the other thing is, it makes you wonder with our students, where are we going to be in 5 or 10 years? Students are having problems with learning something. Well, what are we going to do? Are we going to say, go to tutorial support, go get assisted learning support systems, or are we going to say, here, put on this, or will they do it themselves? Put on a headband and say, I now realize my most productive time is 3 o'clock in the afternoon or 4 a.m. in the morning, and that's when I should write my papers. And what do we do when the school, when the institution says, if you wear a tracking device or a headband-like thing or something that reads your brain waves over 4 years, we can guarantee you better academic success? I don't know. You have to think about these things, because we may reach that point. So anyway, so in terms of developing a wearable tech strategy, take a deep breath, okay? We're not there yet, and I can't give you the strategy. All I can say is some dynamics about where we're going and what will happen. I do think this is not just a continuation of the wearable revolution. This will be a whole new revolution in technology. First and foremost, always, always remember that we overestimate the effect of technology in the short term, and we underestimate it in the long term. A year from now, things aren't going to be that different. 5 or 10 years from now, things will be radically different. But if we're going to plan ahead and anticipate what's coming, we do need to do that. Secondly, we can't ignore the future. This, to me, is one of the most embarrassing sights on technology and education ever. New York City schools, until January of this year, banned smartphones in the schools. being a nice entrepreneurial city with lots of immigrants, guess what people did? They set up trucks, parked them in front of the schools, put cubicles in the trucks. You could leave your phone for a dollar a day. The kids would not leave their phones at home because they needed their phones on the walk to or from school and were willing to spend the $100, $200-something a year extra to have their phones with them, and would leave their phones outside the school door in the truck, pick them up at the end of the day when they walked out of school. Now that's changed finally, which is good, but we don't want this to happen with wearables, right? This can't. So anyways, just some key things I'll run through very, very quickly on social media, mobile learning, the transparency factor, learning spaces, new interfaces, and of course the big question about knowledge down the road and what we need to know. First of all, we're already hyper-connected. We're going to be even more hyper-connected with wearables. How do we leverage this for learning? How do we keep this from being a distraction? I find it one thing to have my phone doing notifications all day long. My phone's in my pocket. The watch is a different thing, and I've had to turn notifications off because I don't want my wrist being tapped all the time every time something's coming in or there's a tweet or something or a message or, you know, just something that I go. It's something of a distraction, though it's good to have information here. So we really have to think about this. Clay Shirky, of course, the media theorist at NYU, recently wrote a piece where he said he's just banning technology in his classroom after trying to leverage it for so long. And it's tough, obviously. I mean, if you're sitting there in class and you get a notification on your Facebook page that your ex posted something, or on Twitter or something like that, it's very hard to listen to the instructor or your fellow students, right? You're going to go, my ex did what? or somebody I'm interested in. It's really tough. With wearables, I think mobile learning will no longer be information access. It will be visual. It will be experiential. Very, very true with Google Cardboard, but also with Oculus Rift and other ways. And eventually, we're just going to have this in our eyeglasses. I mean, we are going to reach that point. And in terms of wearables, they are simply going to disappear. We're not going to be able to tell when somebody is wearing one. Already, we have so many challenges with the standardized exams in nursing, and I walk by the classrooms at the end of the semester. The coats are by the door, the smartphones are by the door, the jewelry's by the door, everything's, the only thing students have left is they have their clothes on. That's it. You know, at some point, you're just going to go, what are you going to say, take off your glasses? You're not going to be able to do that. Simply is going to disappear. And Sagata Mitra, the professor at Newcastle that did the Hole in the Wall project and has been trying to get national education systems to change standardized testing, has said, if only I could get mobile devices into the testing centers, it would change everything, because we'd stop asking stupid questions in our exams. We'd have to ask questions that you couldn't Google the answer to. Of course, so far, there's been no takers to his proposal here, as you might imagine, but I think he's going to get his way in the end, because people are just going to have devices you won't see. In terms of our classrooms, Google body slammed the libraries, did they not? I think virtual reality is going to body slam our classrooms, because when you can sit there on your dorm room floor or your living room and conjure up all sorts of 3D immersive experiences, it's going to be a challenge to go to class and listen to somebody talk. It's going to be a real challenge, unless they're really, really good, okay? But it's going to be tough, because we're going to have a much, much richer learning experience that students are going to have access to them on their own. And you can ask, finally, if this is the basis of your new interface. Google, at their I.O. conference, announced Project Jacquard, which is really conductive threads that will be woven into your clothing. It's absolutely, it's wild, it's crazy, it's one of their moonshots, who knows if it will work, but they did a demo of it, and it seems like it's got real possibilities. And this, you can have it invisible in your clothes so that you can't even see it. You can have it so that you can see it. It can be done on industrial looms. There's no special equipment that's needed to get this into our clothing. So what this means is basically we could have track pads all over our clothes. We could have interfaces all over our walls. it could change everything. Long, long time, people, we've been using the mouse, have we not, since 1969 when Douglas Engelbert in San Francisco introduced it. It was like an 8-inch box at the time. And it is reaching the point where we may move on to a different kind of interface. Now, I'm not sure what happens with social media when we start getting notifications through our clothes, but we'll have to see. Finally, last but not least, the big question here, of course, is what is knowledge? If everything is instantly accessible, if we do have access, which we will at some point down the road, to virtual assistants, ultimately, what do we need to know? What do we teach our students? What do we need to know? Okay, we're already running into this in certain fields. Airline pilots now in a modern commercial jetliner, what? The plane will pretty much land itself. Really would land itself the whole way down, wheels down on the runway, yet most pilots still take over the last 500 feet or something like that and do the landing manually. But different airlines are different. Some say, no, you have to do it. Others will say it's at the discretion of the pilot. We're going to reach the point where we have to say, what do our students absolutely have to know, and what do they just need to be able to access? Which is someone who started in philosophy way, way back when, many years ago at the New School. It's fascinating that I find myself fascinated that I come back to a question that I was asking myself at the very beginning of my academic career, which is what do we need to know? And I think that wearable technology is going to bring that right into the forefront in the next 5 to 10 years. So anyways, questions, comments, anything at all? Thank you very much. Much appreciated. Yes.